So Jay and John, thank you so much for being with me today and really discussing this very important topic of precision medicine and oncology. John, let me start with you. What is your view on the topic of precision medicine and oncology?
Yeah, thanks, Susanna. As we think about all the advancements that we've made in science, we've made significant contributions in terms of increasing the lifespan for human beings as a whole. And I think what we've done is really improve the care of patients in total. But what's the next step? Because we're seeing science accelerate so fast. It's really this transition from treating a large population of patients to precision medicine, which is we can narrow down on what that population, where the benefits are for patients. And I think we're really making some significant strides in the advancements overall in precision medicine. Since 2005, we've had at least 8 novel assets which have been enabled or accelerated, whether it's at launch or label expansion through precision medicine.
Yeah, let's move to Jay. So Jay, can you share a little bit your thoughts about precision medicine in oncology and how you feel we are progressing? Are we on the right track?
Thank you, Susanna. Cancer remains an impossible challenge. But today, guided by insights into fundamental disease biology, understanding the causative genetic events that lead to cancer, the development of pretty predictive preclinical models of the disease, and fueled by just radical advances in our ability to make targeted medicines, the science of therapeutics. I mean, never before have we had such a chance to respond to the impossible burden of cancer, but there is a lot of work to do. But what has changed over the last 10 years is the consideration of cancers not by their tissue of origin, but by the genetic and non-genetic programs that drive them. That a targeted therapy for a specific gene that activates and causes cell growth can be used in a lung cancer, a colon cancer, and perhaps other cancers. This whole reconsideration of the treatment of cancer is opening new doors to the invention of therapeutics. Having access to those medicines and becoming a part of their early clinical study, helping to establish signs of efficacy. It's such an important collaboration between drug hunters and patients.
What I found very surprising is that not every patient wants to know. I wonder, what are your thoughts? Have you experienced this when you were still in clinics?
You know, facing the diagnosis of cancer as an individual is an impossible circumstance. There was a time in medicine where it was quite common for patients and patients' families to try to protect themselves or their loved one from the emotional burden of knowing what they're facing. My personal opinion is that to take a patient through a cytotoxic chemotherapy, a surgery, or even a targeted therapy does require consent and awareness and appreciation of what they're being treated for. But in this day and age, it is important if patients are to be treated that they understand what they're being treated for.
In these specific situations, however, you do have to take a step back, and it is the role of whether that's the caretaker or the role of the physician actually to find the best approach to treating these patients. And in this approach, it may be that precision medicine allows them to have a more specific and actually more tailored treatment so that they don't have to potentially go through maybe something like chemotherapy, which spares them maybe of the harmful side effects at times. So ultimately, that's all what we're striving for, to provide the best treatment for the patient.
Let me switch gears a little bit and talk about healthcare systems and what it means for these systems, you know, to integrate precision medicine. We need broad screening. We need broad molecular diagnostics. John, any perspective on that?
Yeah, I do think that healthcare systems play a significant role in precision medicine as we look at this entire ecosystem. So if we take a step back and think about precision medicine, well, what happens with precision medicine? You actually are tailored so that you can diagnose patients potentially a little bit earlier. So the impact is that you know who the patients are. It actually decreases the overall cost. Secondly, What about the patient experience and what happens to the patients? Well, if patients actually feel better in the treatment, it actually will also result in potentially better outcomes as they have better hope in the approach. And thirdly, it's really around the outcomes, particularly in oncology. If the patients survive longer, you obviously have less of an impact on the overall healthcare system as a whole. Registries absolutely do help because it gives us the framework of understanding the disease and how we can move forward in terms of treatments for the patients.
Yeah. And Jay, of course, you and your teams, you're really working on the forefront of science. And you are producing wonderful new assets that really can completely transform cancer. Do you think healthcare systems are ready for that?
Well, I do, Susanna. There's just an incredible demand from patients and healthcare systems for better treatments for advanced cancer. The greatest public health impact in cancer care derives from prevention. Localized solid tumors may be surgically removed. Many, but not all, blood cancers can be cured with chemotherapy, sometimes targeted therapy. But the majority of advanced cancers are not curable. And that's the challenge that we have to approach with modern science. And so we have a list of the genes that contribute to these cancers. We have a list of the proteins that define certain cell types. And we knock them down one by one with chemistry, biotherapeutics, and directed radiotherapy, trying to build a toolbox of medicines first tested in advanced cancer to prolong life and reduce the suffering from cancer, but ultimately medicines that might be used to improve the prevention of cancer. Cancer is so challenging once it's advanced. It's very heterogeneous. It can respond and then become resistant to disease. But today, with so many weapons, immunotherapies that direct the immune system at the cancer, the ability to reprogram T cells with gene therapies to fight cancer, and modern oral, typically, medicines that target the causative genes that led to the development of that cancer, we have so many weapons in our arsenal. We're now able to detect cancer-associated genes in the bloodstream even before the shadow appears on an X-ray or CAT scan. And so we start to imagine now the use of this type of information to direct the study of targeted therapy in patients who have yet to be diagnosed with cancer. And there, I think, is the greatest promise for better public health impact.
Yeah, so that creates a lot of hope, Jay. And I'm really confident that I think if we all continue to work on it, we will tackle cancer at some point. So, John, is this more an opportunity or are there challenges?
That we need to work very closely with the health authorities and the regulatory authorities and well as the reimbursement payers so that they see this as an opportunity. So as we move forward advancing the technologies, we have to balance that the environment that supports this also helps us move forward. We really need the help of the entire healthcare ecosystem because despite the fact that we develop these technologies, we have to put them into use.
There's no question that in some tumor types, understanding the molecular biology, sequencing the genome to find the causative mutations that are driving the cancer can lead to the use of an approved medicine in many instances, but much more broadly can lead to an insight that directs the patient to an investigational medicine, a clinical trial. There are really interesting so-called umbrella studies ongoing right now in many tumor types that seek to test whether having the information, having the sequencing information for a cancer can lead to a more effective therapy for the patient. This is a new way of sort of reversing the clinical trial and say, let's take all the patients with a certain cancer, find the mutations that they have, and then go find medicines for them, investigational or established. And I love it because it's so patient-centric.
Yeah, fascinating, really, how we have to reverse things. Can you share a little bit, John, what that means for Novartis? How do we work around precision medicine across all the functions?
Yeah, thanks, Susanna. And, you know, as I said earlier, science is accelerating at a rapid pace. And what we've saw is that we really needed to adapt and also evolve our model. So last year, a couple of us got together and looked at how do we have a seamless model to go from the beginning to the end in terms of harmonizing all of the efforts across not only just the Novartis ecosystem, but the broader healthcare ecosystem, working with the scientists as well as academic institutions. So what we actually decided to do was to have a goal as an entire team, starting from the early research in development all the way through commercialization, that 100% of our programs actually would have precision medicine as a goal. And obviously we've learned from that, because not only are we adopting that for the oncology assets, but we're also looking at it beyond oncology and other disease areas, such as in multiple sclerosis. So we're looking at it as an entire portfolio, looking at this as an approach for the overall portfolio, not just in oncology.
Yeah, sounds great. And Jay, you mentioned, of course, that we want to be really patient-centric, that we really go from what, you know, what mutations are expressed on their tumors, and then we want to find therapies. And of course, to do that, what we will need, if we have a promising molecular asset in your shop, we also would need a diagnostics. Can you maybe share how diagnostics are developed?
I used to hear all the time before I came to work at a pharmaceutical company, when I was a professor and working at an academic cancer center, that drug companies probably don't want to know which subset of patients most benefit from a therapy, because then they may sell fewer medicines. And honestly, nothing could be further from the truth, at least here at Novartis, where we can most efficiently deliver the greatest impact when we know exactly who the patient is that will best respond to our therapies. The trials are smaller, the impact is greater. And that's what we're all here to do, is deliver the greatest impact that we can. But we find that sometimes when a medicine goes out into the world for general use, the medicine is available, but the diagnostic isn't. And so we need to work shoulder to shoulder with diagnostics innovators and diagnostics companies. This requires collaboration throughout the invention and early testing, and then the definitive testing of the cancer medicine, so that the FDA and the EMA and other regulatory agencies around the world can have the confidence that this specific diagnostic test reports on the use of this specific medicine.
I think really partnerships between academia, companies, and diagnostics experts is really critical to really provide the full package. I know you're very passionate about data and digital. Is this an area that can support how we approach precision medicine?
Yeah, Susanna, data and digital plays such a critical role. So as we collect the information, whether that's from liquid biopsies or tissue samples, what you can see is if we could break those down and get a better, even better understanding through the power of analytics, I think this accelerates our path to actually diagnosis and treatment of patients.
Jay? Anything to share? How you apply data and digital to your science?
Well, as you know, Susanna, drug discovery is a data business. We collect massive amounts of data, petabytes of data around genetics and the response of tumors to medicines, how their genes go up and go down in their regulation. There's a real renaissance in data science right now, and I like to think we're really very much at the bleeding edge. We're using computer science and virtual reality to drive our improvement of prototype drugs. We can put on these goggles and literally put our hands on a protein pocket and peer inside. As we sculpt in a more artisanal way, we have about 18 applications at NIBR right now of this artificial intelligence to expedite drug discovery so that we can respond faster to patients with our new ideas.
Thank you so much for your time and your insights. And it's really amazing to see your passion that I share. We want to improve outcome for cancer patients and redefine the C-word cancer, and maybe at some point really move it to cure.